Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 4 of the Worldwide Wrestling Exhibition Series, the Journeyman's Cup Tournament. I am Nathan Paletta. I am the designer and publisher of the Worldwide Wrestling role-playing game, which is what we'll be playing tonight. Thank you for joining us. As I said, this is our fourth episode, so if you have not been following along, you can check out the previous three on YouTube, on my YouTube channel. And if you have been following around along, welcome. Excited to have you back. So at this point, we have a total roster of about 7 characters that come in and out, depending on which players are available on any given night that we're able to play. And so this is showcasing one of the features of the game, the rotating attendance feature, where it is actually, you know, it is designed to support this kind of fluctuating attendance kind of group. So I'm glad that we're able to do that and watch it as it progresses. Tonight we have 4 characters that we've already met, so we're not going to be doing heat or doing any intro stuff for them. If you want to know more, like I said, you can check out the older episodes. But we have, I'm just going to go down the list, talk a little bit about the storyline, and then we'll have the guys introduce themselves and their characters. So we have Jason playing Professor Atomo, the veteran gimmick. We have Scythe, who used to be Razor Jackson, played by Matthew, and he's the hardcore gimmick, who recently made a heel turn. He was a babyface, and he is now, after a dastardly over-the-top attack, is now a heel. And that attack was on Joey Crak, played by Joe, the Golden Boy gimmick, and rejoining us after an episode off on a vision quest is a blind man Simons, played by Adams, and he's playing one of the season 1 gimmicks, which are a limited set of 5 additional archetypes that are available to Kickstarter backers for now, and he's playing the provocateur. So all these characters are in the Journeyman's Cup tournament, which is an annual bracketed tournament in the Worldwide Wrestling promotion. Whoever wins the tournament gets the Journeyman's Cup, which they carry around with them, and has the ability to challenge for the Pan-Oceanic World title, aka the POW belt. They make a challenge by scheduling a match and you know, issuing the what type of match they want and everything to the current title holder. However, whoever holds the cup can be challenged for it in turn. So, you know, in the annual, you know, season of storytelling, in this promotion, creates a tension between, like, how long do they hold it, do they get challenged for it, give it up, and whoever wins it then has the ability to challenge for the title down the road. So it's a little more, has a little difference from, like, a Money in the Bank thing or something like that. So that's what we're all about in this exhibition series. The first couple of episodes were focused more on going through the mechanics of the game, and at this point, since we have recurring characters and we have people who have all played before, we're just basically going to play and just go through new stuff as it comes up. So we're going to take a moment and just go through our characters. Each of you just give us a couple sentences about your guy, and, you know, for new viewers or to refresh our audience on who we're playing with. So we'll start with Matthew.
Hey, I'm playing, excuse me, Scythe, formerly Razor Jackson. I imagine he still looks mostly the same, kind of like a Midwest Andrew WK, long stringy hair. Still has whatever punk rock or metal t-shirts he can scrounge up. Usually local bands for cheap heat. Cut off jeans, but now he's started sporting, because he's evil now. He's started sporting a leather studded vest, because he's evil. And usually at the beginning of the night, he'll have like skull face paint, and that'll wear off as he wrestles, as it is one to do. He recently was abducted by Reaper into the Graveyard faction, and we'll see how that shapes out.
All right, and then Joe, tell us about Joey Crak.
All right, playing Joey Crak, he's a very obnoxious, arrogant, overconfident, very much in the vein of old school Stevie Richards and thinks, you know, like, the world will bow to him, basically. And, you know, as for, like, look, he's got a, you know, average like, haircut. You know, it's, you know, generally, like, slick back or styled. And he wears sort of, like, you know, dark blue and black tights. And, you know, like one of, like, the vet sort of a, not quite the tank top, but sort of like the super crazy type singlet, you know, where, like, his arms are bare, but it's not like a wife beater type tank.
Right on, right on. And Jason, tell us about Professor Atomo.
I am playing Professor Atomo. To give you the full title, he is Professor Atomo, the Headmaster of Heavyweights, the Maestro of Musculature, the Atomic Academic. He's the veteran playbook, and he's a little bit of an older guy. He looks a little bit like a professor from an old 1950s black and white movie, only older and with a bit of a gut, even while being fairly muscle bound. He comes out in a singlet that has his Atomo symbol on it. He's been getting a little bit of pop recently, so he's been thinking about updating the look, but it's kind of a classic. Most of the time when he's not wrestling, he'll be wearing a tweed jacket and his horn-rimmed glasses and smoking his pipe. He's a good guy, but a bit of a jerk.
As are we all. And Adams, tell us about Blind Man Simons.
Blind Man Simons is he's kind of a skinny guy. He's got an entirely shaved head, and he wears all black, and he wears a blindfold. And when he fights, he takes off that blindfold, and he's got one red contact and one green contact that make his eyes look like solid, those colors. He's definitely small for a wrestler, and he honestly can't wrestle all that well, but people like him anyway because of his crazy gimmick that he can see the future.
Awesome. All right. So we'll do a quick recap. On our last episode, we saw the in-ring return of Joey Crak, who did manage to pull off a win against Scythe and the Bones, as he came out with the graveyard minions called Bones in a graveyard match, basically a lumberjack match, but it slanted towards the faction. Joey came out, but he made some slip-ups. He made some flubs on the mic, and kind of they had to do some hasty rewriting backstage. while there is no proof that he cheated to win that hard-fought victory, he did manage to squeak one out. But he was for all of his effort, he was met with a vicious beating at the hands of the graveyard afterwards, cementing Scythe's heel turn. And then later in the night, we had Bolt Bradshaw, the exciting high flyer, call out Professor Atomo and put his skills on the line in a wrestling science match, which was a match that was scored on technical wrestling ability and not by pinfalls, submissions, and that kind of stuff. Despite Bolt's braggadocio, Professor Atomo proved that he's truly, as I've been calling him, the dean of wrestling science, and won that 3-0. And that was a tournament match that brought Professor Atomo into the semifinals of the Journeyman's Cup tournament, which we've established he has won before. So he's kind of coming out of retirement and running the board a little bit. Currently, the tournament standings, we have gone through kind of the first cycle of matches, and we're kind of in the middle of the second. We're going to aim to kind of wrap that up and get to a solid launching point for the rest of the story tonight. Blind Man Simons is out of the tournament. He got knocked out by Bolt. And Brainberg, the jobber gimmick, who we saw in the first episode, was defeated in that because he's the jobber, and so he loses. He is not in the tournament either. Joey Crak is in the second round. We established that he had beaten Stick Boy in a first round tournament match, and Razor also had a first round match that ended in a DQ against kind of old money prep guy, Aiden Anthony. That ended in a DQ. There's been some controversy about the ending of that match. And also, that match overlapped with Reaper's win and then his subsequent disappearance. So we'll probably be doing some stuff with that tonight as well. Elsewhere on the card, Aurora, a crowd favorite, kind of rock and roll style high flyer, beat the totalitarian Mega American, all caps, to advance to the semifinals. So we'll be seeing her fairly soon. And there's a crowd favorite, good old boy from Oklahoma, Travis Mealmaker, who has been doing pretty well in the tournament, beat the mysterious Mercury to advance to round two. And so he's kind of in contention with all these guys. There's a little graphic for the brackets. I finally had some time to set that up. I'll try and put that in the show notes or description or whatever after we're done. Anyway, that's the boring stuff. That's it. We're going to start playing now. So here we go. First of all, we'll do some top-of-the-show mechanical stuff. First, does anyone have any advances that they earned at any point that they would like to spend?
I totally do. I've got an advance that I want to spend to take a move from another playbook. I would like to take Just Gets It from the Athlete playbook, because, like, although Blind Man Simons is, like, all about look right now, he really wishes he could actually wrestle. And so he's paying a lot of attention to the people he's wrestling with and trying to learn what he can from them. The Just Gets It move lets him, whenever I lose a match to someone who has a higher work than I do, I can choose to lose all my heat with them. If I do, I take +1 work.
All right, on. Yeah, so you're kind of showing some natural ability to learn from your failures.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Any other advances from anyone? I don't think anyone else has one.
Unless... I do.
Oh, you did. Okay.
I do. I have one advance, and I have the overmove. My advance.
Go ahead and spend your advance first, unless you don't want to spend it right now. But.
No, I just go ahead and spend it because I'm going to up my look, because the fact is I end up working a mic and working the crowd a lot, and it makes sense to me that the professor coming out of retirement is getting people coaching him and making him look good. So I'm just going to go ahead and bring my look up to a +1 because Professor Adama. and that
you're
matters.
You're getting actually. It back. You're getting your spark back.
That's right. Build up the momentum. Speaking of which, because I'm over, I get another momentum.
Yep.
And so I will go ahead and do that. So that puts me at 3 for the top here.
Well,
because it's 2 for audience 3, and then you get +1 for being...
Well, you're at audience 4, so it's...
Yeah.
You just get the +1. For the overall.
So I don't get the same +2 momentum I would if I was audience 3?
Correct.
Weird.
Because you could, because on your overroll, you could spend that on...
Oh, I see what you're saying. All right. So,
or you can spend it on other stuff.
Yeah, no, that's fine. So I just start with +1, just so I'm clear on that?
Yes.
All right. Man, that's rough. All right.
It's not rough for you. I think you ended the last episode with like 7 or something.
I may have done. All right, so let me roll for over here.
Mm-hmm. Roll plus look.
And I rolled 6 plus my look brings me to a 7, so I just managed to squeak that one out there.
That advance.
So I get to either demand to be granted any match I want, call out anyone on the roster and gain 1 heat, or gain +1 momentum. And I think that I'm happiest taking the momentum. And part of that actually goes back to what I was saying before we started about it, the idea that the professor is starting a new faction. So that's kind of the narrative excuse for additional momentum, is him doing that.
Awesome. So we'll see some of that. Cool. Are there any other things before we get started? I think that covers...
Yeah. I've never been in a session with Joey Crack before. What does my heat start at? Plus zero?
You guys are both heals, so you start at zero.
Okay.
You kind of been introduced at different times, so we never learned any of your backstory. So you have some... If you guys want to work together, you'll have some work to beef it up. But yeah, start at zero. Cool. Anything else?
I'd like a vignette on my way back from the desert.
Oh, you'll get it. You'll get it. I have that. We're not going to do it first, though. But that's on my list. Because here's how I want to start. We cut into the cheering crowd and the color commentary on the side. Welcome everyone to another exciting episode of Worldwide Wrestling. We're coming to you live tonight from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We're in fact coming from the 2300 Arena, which us wrestling nerds know as the old ECW Arena in Philly. So it's a pretty intimate venue, big balconies, lots of people packed in there. Things have been going pretty well. So the audience, you know, it's pretty full and pretty hot. People are cheering, people are excited. So yeah, coming to you live tonight from Philadelphia, they pan over the crowd, there's a lot of cheering. There's Professor Atomo signs, there's wrestling science signs. People are pretty pumped for that. And I think there are people in Bones, like, cosplay, like just wearing like black with like the white, like little kind of face paint, kind of like how Scythe does it. And some people have gotten like, you know, the black gloves with a little skeleton like graphic on it, where they're holding those up and like waving their hands. Because the graveyard is kind of getting over as this weird, evil, dominant faction. We get welcomed, and then we cut backstage to a candid, if you will, vignette. So this is your there's no interviewer. You're not talking directly to the camera, but Joey Crack, you're there backstage with General Manager C. Colton Craig. I don't remember if he's come up in person before, but he's a pretty well built, athletic former wrestler. Pretty shaved head, wears a nice blue suit. Fairly attractive man. Who's known for, you know, coming out and bringing down the law on people when they start getting out of line. So he has his arms around Joey's shoulders, and the camera is kind of like behind him and kind of over the both of your shoulder, and he's saying, "Joey, look, I know the graveyard is getting on your nerves, but you got to focus. You have to focus on what's in front of you here. I mean, you know that you're my pick to win this whole tournament, right?"
"Well, of course, Craig. There's nobody better than Crack."
"It's like, I know that. I know that. That's why I brought you back. That's why I brought you back. That's why I got you the therapist, got you, you know, all the help you needed to rehab from your injury, and got you back here. Because really, at the end of the day, Joey, it's just I just believe in you. You know,
as well you should. Who else can carry this company? Atomo, that relic, the Boneheads and Reaper, and that little those wannabe goth kids. No, that's not going to fly. I'm the future of this company. You know it, and I know it, and the world knows it."
They're definitely going to know tonight. But like I said, you need to stay focused. You can't. Don't worry about the graveyard.
Be distracted. Trust me. I don't fear the Reaper.
All right. So look, you focus. Set your sights on Mealmaker. He's your guy tonight. He's been tearing it up, but you know he's a little older too, and I know you can take him. And then he leans over and starts whispering into your ear, like he has a secret plan. Sorry, am I coming through okay?
Yeah, it's just some static.
There's just a little static on the edges.
Little fuzzy, but I can't hear you.
Okay, sorry. I think I realized what I was doing. I'll stop doing that. Cool. So, Joe, is there anything else you want to have in this segment? Or else this is just kind of setting up some stuff later in the show.
No, I think that's a perfectly good opening segment.
All right. Cool. So the camera cuts from that.
Of an attractive man who's whispering in his ear.
Yeah. Right.
For some reason I see him as like Mills Lane.
Wrestling. So the camera cuts. The producer, whoever runs these things backstage, lets you know that the camera's off. And so Craig like leans back a little bit. Because he was just, like, mumbling in your ear just for the camera. He wasn't actually saying anything. And he's like, but Joe, seriously, like, we really need you to look strong tonight, because otherwise this whole idea is just going to fall apart.
Yeah, I got it. You know, last city, God knows what, there was a fluke. Bizarro town over there.
So, like, this is Philly. They should be a little more into your thing. So, you know, just play it up. But, you know, don't go too crazy on Travis. He is having some problems with his knees.
Okay. No problem. I'm professional. I'm not likely to slip and just try to injure someone. This is a job. This is what we do.
That would never happen with you.
I'm not the hardcore.
Okay, so that was off camera, so I'm just kind of being clear for everyone that I'm going to start trying to add in a little more off camera stuff as we're getting more into the story. So,
Craig, one thing, obviously, this tournament's main concern, I think long run, seeking revenge on Scythe for the whole table thing. Maybe we could think about that.
So I'll talk to him about it. I mean, it makes sense. I see it, but at the same time, there's the whole graveyard thing. There's another angle we're thinking of pushing it. But I mean, if you really feel strongly about it, I can try to work it back in. I'll talk to Tina.
Okay.
You know, she has to sign off on all that stuff.
Of course.
Great. So that's all happening off camera. On camera, we are cutting to the pre-recorded segment of what Blind Man Simons has to say from his vision quest that he was off on last episode. So what does that look like? Is it a whole produced thing, or is it just Simons talking to the camera?
What I think it might actually be is like, it's the middle of the night. I'm walking down a road in the middle of the desert. I guess like last time we filmed somewhere where there actually is a desert. And on the way back, Tina shows up to interview me about what's happened, what I've seen. That all right? I can't hear you.
He went off mic for a second, but none of us can hear him, even though his lips are moving.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't think he's still muted. Vamp. So, the Rockbirds then. No, that's...
Wrong
franchise.
We could go ahead and play up to Tina and Tina for a moment, or you could describe some of the like crazy psychedelic imagery that comes through leading up to it, like old 1960s film.
Sure. So the like the screen starts out just like totally black and slowly fades in a like single point of gold like just in the middle of the screen. It expands outward and it's a circle, and inside that circle there is like red and green in kind of a weird paisley pattern. Right? And there's black in between the red and the green, and as it expands outward over the screen, getting brighter and brighter, you see that actually the black in between the red and green is the night sky out in the desert, and it expands out, all the patterns expand out past the edge of the screen, and the camera pans down to the street that I'm walking down, the road that I'm walking down. And
I think Nate would be fine if you wanted to describe your stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. He seemed into it pre-show, so.
And so, and what?
I just told Nate on text I could use Timmy Tahini and interview with him if you want.
Sounds good.
All right. So as you're walking alone, kind of with Blair Witch style, like light on him. He's like, come on guys, we found him. Blind man, where have you been? Blind man, what have you seen?
I've been out communing with the desert spirits, Timmy. And they and I, we've seen some things. We've seen what's wrong with this company. We've seen what's going on. We've seen what needs to be done.
What are these dire predictions?
You see, wrestling science should never have come back. Wrestling science was dead and gone. Professor Atomo was dead and gone. He should never have interfered in that match. He should never have fought Bolt Bradshaw. He should never have won against Bolt Bradshaw. And things need to be set right.
But Blind Man, wasn't he your mentor? Weren't you learning from Professor Atomo?
Yes, certainly, I was. And that's what he should have remained. A teacher and a trainer. He was no wrestler. Not a wrestler fit for the modern WWW. No. He is a man of the past, where I am a man of the future. And when the Desert Spirits and I saw this, the Desert Spirits, they gave me a weapon that will guarantee my victory over Professor Atomo.
Can you share that with the fans at home And with me, blind man, can you share what the spirits have given you?
I look straight at the camera and I just laugh. Check, check, check. Can hear you. Yeah.
Can hear you fine.
Hello?
Yep, yes. We can hear you.
Okay, I'm back. That was so weird. I'm sorry, guys. That was a very cool promo. I liked the two-thirds of it that I heard while I was trying to get my...
Strong words from Blind Man Simmons. Clearly, this vision quest of his paid off, and he has a vision for the future of this company.
Shall I roll for it?
Awesome, yes, roll. Roll plus look. I won't touch anything else.
All right, I got 10 plus 2 is 12.
12, nice.
So I get to gain plus 1 momentum, and I think I just demanded a match with Professor Atomo.
I think you sure did. That is going on the card as we speak. Awesome. Okay. Fantastic. Yeah, so that was, you know, up on the that was displayed up on the Tron or whatever for the live audience. And we cut back and you know, it's not like over the top cheers and stuff, because it's not that kind of material that was presented, right? But people are definitely interested, and the people who are holding, you know, Atomo signs and wrestling science signs and stuff are making a big fuss, standing up, you know, shaking their signs at the camera, because they don't want to see their wrestling science be taken down, right? Like that's no good at all. And that that is when so the camera's just kind of panning over the crowd, and the commentator's like, it's like, well, you know, with those strong words from the blind man, you know, will Professor Tomo be able to, you know, will he yet again be able to prove his mastery of wrestling science, or is this or is this the first real threat that he's facing since his return? And then while they're chattering, suddenly the lights go down. The mist starts rising from the entrance ramp, and we have the entrance of Scythe, and perhaps some of the bones if you want. I don't know how many you want around with you, but you're coming in here's the deal. Reaper has chosen you, right? Maybe we do a little. We're going to do a little backstage segment that leads into this entrance. Everyone's waving their signs, you know, yelling for about that promo that just went down. Then lights go down, and the Tron goes back on, and we're having a backstage. Where a backstage thing is just like misty, and maybe there's just some like kind of white, you know, kind of sketched out in white, like gravestones or something. Around behind you, and it's you and the looming form of Reaper, right, who we haven't seen for a couple episodes. And the camera's on Scythe's face as you're, like, looking up at him. Reaper reaches down and he places his hands on your two shoulders, my enormous hands, on your two shoulders. And he's just like, I can't do a stretch voice, but he's just like, you know, I have other things that I must be doing to strengthen the graveyard and grow our power. That means that you, Scythe, are my champion.
for the Journeyman's Cup tournament. You are taking my place, and you will succeed. And then that's when, and then that goes black, and that's when the mist comes up, and you enter out to the live audience. So this is a you're being given a little platform to talk for the first time, really, since you got abducted, I think, about you know, your deal and what you're doing for Reaper and all that business.
Yeah, I think I cut a little promo last episode, but nothing too big.
Yeah, you did a little bit last episode, that's true. Well, this is more about the tournament and you being made as champion and that thing, so.
Right.
If you have anything you want to add.
Yeah. So I come out and it's the same sort of entrance Reaper has, just sort of it's not the same music, but it's sort of like drop D metal. Really low, not very aggressive, and the mist and stuff. And I come out, and I'm just standing at the top of the ramp. You know, I've been talking to some spirits too. Spirits everywhere, if you know how to look. Well, I was out in the parking lot, and I talked to a soda can spirit, and I talked to an empty bag of Cheetos spirit. And then I went over to the playground, and I walked in the desert too. And I take my shoe off, and I turn it up, and I shake a bunch of sand out. And you know what I learned? Some people talk too damn much. Reaper chose me. He knew that his influence was going to need to be felt over the course of this tournament. But he had bigger fish. So he picked me to keep these fools in line. Wrestling science, wrestling magic, you're forgetting the key word. Wrestling. That's it.
Awesome. I like that a lot. I think you told him what you thought. I think you just got a promo. Roll close look there, buddy.
What do I got here? Oh, I got a 2. This is good. Dice stream is still broken, so everyone just has to trust. I got a 5, so I have a 7.
All right. See,
as long as I roll poorly when dice stream is broken, you guys will believe me.
All right. Cool. That is good.
I don't have it in front of me because I'm a jerk.
You can.
I have it. Okay.
I can book you in a match, add a stipulation to a match, gain a momentum, or gain a heat with, I think, either Simons or Professor Atomo. I think they were both in your promo.
I think I'm going to take a heat with Blind Man.
Nice. Start aiming at him a little bit.
Yeah. So now I have 2.
You're like, I'm in the weird supernatural faction. I don't believe in magic.
Whatever. That's the.
Yeah. That's not magic. That's bullshit. That's not like this weird necromantic craziness that
I'm. That's different. It's a different thing.
That's wrestling. Is what that is.
Necromancy, skeletons.
Right.
Metal. It's all wrestling.
Right. Awesome. So. As you know, so as you end that, actually, and that's perfect. You end, you know, you're forgetting the key word, wrestling, and then no music, no package, but you just hear over the speakers, like, you know, you're right about something for once. It is about wrestling. And you turn around, and coming out from the entrance behind you is Aiden Anthony, who, as I said, is the more kind of prep style, you know, crew guy, you know, East Coast preppy kind of guy, who you maybe defeated in the first episode. He comes out and he's like, you're talking so big about wrestling. Last time we wrestled, you didn't even know how to tie up. You didn't know what a suplex was. You just kept hitting me with a chair. That's not wrestling. That's garbage. That's garbage. You're garbage. This Reaper guy is garbage. And I've had enough of all this weird bullshit that you guys are trying to pull over this audience here in Philadelphia that's here to see us compete like athletes and put on an athletic contest to prove who's better. You know who's better? I'm better. And that's why we're going to have a rematch for our tournament slot right now. My dad talked to C. Colton Craig, and he got this approved. So ring the bell ringing guy. Let's do this. They ring the bell. You're in your rematch with Aiden Anthony for this next tournament slot.
All right. As he goes to get in the ring, I hit him with a chair.
before the match starts?
Yeah.
Are you trying to actually hurt him, or just because it's part of your character?
I'm gonna say that one's just like a poke in the eye.
Yeah.
Like, just, you hit me in the chair. Like, yeah, how about now?
Yeah.
How about this one?
All right. Awesome. So he waits for you to go down to the ramp, you know, go down and get in the ring, you know, and then he comes down and he's kind of he went for the cheap pop, he's getting, you know, some Philly cheers. And then he turns around to go to the ring steps and just run up behind him and whack him with the chair.
The power of the hardcore, I can just summon a chair.
It's true, yeah. It's just out of nowhere. You get a chair.
There's a lot of them. It's a big stadium.
Yeah. Let's see. Would anyone like to be commentary or be the announcer for this match in particular?
I like doing commentary. I think Joe was chomping at the bit, though.
Are you about to say anyone other than Joe?
Well, I mean, the thing is, I can't. I guess you could do commentary for every match you're not in. But
it's that thing like in school where the kid knows the answer and you don't want to pick him because you want to make someone work for it.
I just always need somebody to work off of. You know?
Okay, so you have the put over power. You're the announcer. Jason, Timmy Tahini can be on, you know, can be on the
commentary. I don't think I have the power. I just like being cool. Jesse Ventura.
He just likes talking shit during our matches.
I'm happy to be the Timmy Tahini to his put-over power from Jesse. It's good.
Sounds good. We'll do that. If you want an alter ego at the announce desk, Adams, you're free to make one as well. But we'll start with that. So,
Aiden Anthony is also a heel.
He started as a heel, and he's trying to work. He's trying to tack his way back towards babyface, but he doesn't really know how to do it.
Okay.
he slided, and that just sort of pushed him into a face.
Yeah, exactly. Your heel turn kind of made him face by default a little bit, but it's in that weird zone where it's like he could just. I mean, he's still calling his dad to get stuff to do stuff for him. So.
I don't see what's wrong with that. Man's a legend.
This may be the all heel episode. we'll see how it goes. So yeah,
he'll win.
You whack him with the chair. He goes sprawling into the ring steps. And the ref comes over and like checks on him and he waves him off and he grabs the mic again. He's like, you would do that. You despicable cheat. That's what you are. I'm going to show you. It's like I'm going to watch out for you. Don't even think about picking up one of those chairs again.
As he's talking, I punch him in the face.
And that's when they ring the bell. They ring the bell when you punch him in the face.
This is how you do things, Timmy. When they're not looking, you cheat. Always cheat. Win when you can, lose if you must, but always cheat. If you can get away with it, nobody can. It doesn't matter.
If no one saw it happen, it didn't happen.
I'm just not sure that Aldenanthe would have approved of this kind of match for his son. I don't think he knew what he was signing Aiden up for.
Well, the man's got he has something to prove. With their last match ending the way it did, and now Scythe, as he's called, getting another shot. Clearly, Aiden's not none too happy about this. But I wasn't too a fan of Scythe before, but now with this new extreme change, he seemed to pick up a few things that I've been maybe he's finally listened to some of my commentary.
Awesome. So, yeah, you clearly start off with control here, Matthew. So you punch him in the face. Yeah. The ref comes over and pushes you away. He'll give him time to, like, roll into the ring.
I was going to say, like, if I remember my wrestling rules correctly, the match doesn't really start until we're both in the ring.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the bell rang. Well, they will wait to ring the bell until both of you are in the ring.
Okay. I'm going to work him over as much as I can before he gets in the ring. So, like, sure. The ref pushes me, and he goes to grab... I grab his leg, and I pull him out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm at when he goes to get up, I'm going to grab him and, like, throw him into the steps.
Mm-hmm. And he's, like... I think he finally... The ref finally just, like, grabs you and just pulls you away from him bodily so he can get in the ring. It sounds like this could be the heel move if you wanted to use it at this point. You're kind of being dastardly.
Not yet.
The Razor I knew would never have done that. This just proves he's gone. There's not a shred of goodness left in him. All that's left is Scythe. All that's left is evil.
I don't see what's wrong with this. I mean, it's clearly something the hometown is familiar with. It's classic brawling. Weaken your opponent before you start the match, then you have the advantage.
Yeah, so he finally manages to roll in underneath the bottom rope. Do you follow him in?
Yeah, I'll try to keep my eye on him as I get in.
Mm-hmm.
He's not gonna like pull a fast one on me, but
right,
expect him to.
Yeah, he takes a couple steps back and lets you get in the ring, and they ring the bell. Match is officially underway, and then he goes into like the tie-up stance, and he doesn't have a mic anymore, but he yells like loud enough that people can hear, like, you know, come on, you know, prove me wrong, Scythe.
So
let's
I'm gonna
let's see your skills.
I'm gonna go up like this, like, you know, like test it, like, okay, yeah. Like you wanna do this?
And yeah, so just it goes to like lock his fingers with yours.
Yeah, just as I get to him, I'm gonna kick him in the gut.
Yeah, classic.
Yeah, and then I'm gonna give him a couple kicks, and I'll grab him, throw him into the ropes. He comes back. I'll just armbar him, and
yeah, just
take
give him
down.
A clothesline.
Yeah. And then I'll just, you know, cheap pop is pretty good.
Yeah, so I think go ahead and you know, this is all your character, you know, this is just how you wrestle. So go ahead and roll plus look for that sequence in the wrestling move.
I again rolled a 5, which gives me a 7. I like these consistent successes.
Consistent minimum success.
Yeah, it's not exciting, but it's consistent. I'm just vamping until I find the paper.
So you can retain control of the match and transition into the next sequence, or you can give me control of the match and gain one momentum.
I'm gonna take the momentum, which means I have.
All right. So you turn around. Excuse me. And you turn around and are you you're turning around to work the audience pretty much?
Yeah, I'll show my back to him.
Yeah. So he gives you a full circuit to get around the ring and you know, yell at the audience or whatever you're doing. So go ahead and roll plus audience for that.
Oh, cool.
Hey, if you're doing it, you do it.
I start at plus one? Yeah, plus one.
Is that your current audience?
Yeah. Because I reset.
Oh, right.
Oh. 4, so 5.
All right. There, so you're walking around.
Probably not the best idea right now. Focusing on the match, Aiden Anthony can't be too happy about this.
And they're not feeling it. You're walking around. The guys with like the bone stuff are cheering, but like you came out and just did, you know, you just went so directly to the beatdown, like without any build up to it, that the ice this is kind of what they, you know, are expecting.
They're like, yeah, you hit him in the head, whatever.
Yeah. Like, oh yeah, you're kicking him. It's not that exciting. You can no longer work the audience this episode. They're not feeling it. So you have a moment where you're like waiting for that pop to come. It's just not coming. So you really kind of stop paying attention to Aiden. And that's when he got up. He runs back. Slingshots himself off the ropes, and comes at you just into the corner with a stinger splash, right, where it just jumps and just splashes you right into the turnbuckle. You're supposed to turn around to take it, right? Like, that's the normal thing to do. But because your attention lapsed, you didn't notice that he was actually coming, so he kind of hits you mid-turn, and it just kind of crunches you into that corner. It's not super bad. You're not taking an injury. Mm-hmm. But it's awkward, and you feel that it is no good. But you're kind of crunched down into the corner, and he's pulling on the ropes, and he starts stomping on you. He's just yelling, like, you know, so he's like, oh, this is how you want to play, huh? Yeah. And just like, you know, how do you like it? He starts stomping into your gut, holding onto the top rope. The ref comes over and grabs him and pulls him away.
I don't like this part as much.
He pulls him away on the count of three, and he waits for you to get up, and you kind of struggle up, and you grab the top rope, and you struggle to your feet, and he comes around and just starts giving you big European uppercuts, where he kind of turns and hits you with the shoulder, with the arm going up, right under the jaw. They're just rocking you back into the corner. Are you going to take this?
No. As he puts me in the corner, I'm gonna try to like grab his arm, and both if I can, and I'm gonna get up to like the second turnbuckle. And I'm just basically, I know I'm in the corner and I'm trying to get out of a tight spot. I'm basically just gonna like try to push him bodily. Like I've got his arms, so I'm just gonna jump and just sort of shove him off,
mm-hmm.
With the intent of just sort of landing on top of him, and just slugging it out for a couple seconds.
Continuing brawl.
Yeah, just sort of like get him off his feet, get out of the corner.
All right, cool. So I still have control, right? So he, you know, you grab his arms, jump off the rope, kind of spin him around and land with him in the middle of the ring. And then he uses the momentum to roll through and ends up on your back, and he grabs your legs and pulls you into his one of his signature submission holds, the boat hitch.
Oh, I hate this guy.
Announcers?
Look at that textbook maneuver. I was afraid at first this was going to turn into a street fight, but it looks like Aiden Anthony's going back to his roots. He's going back to his legacy, and he's really trying to show us what wrestling's all about.
Yeah, he's really tearing it into a Scythe right there. I've seen that boat hitch up close and personal, and I tell you, Timmy, it is not an easy maneuver to get out of.
All right. Is this... Is he going to continue cranking on you here?
I'll let him have it for a little while. I'm stuck in the middle of the ring. Am I on my stomach or on my back when he's got this?
You're on your stomach.
Okay. So I'm going to push my body up, mm-hmm. and try to like, you know, get a little motion going. and then I'm just going to shove up into the air and try to, like, curl myself under to grab him and flip him over and try to get him in a leg lock to sort of reverse the hold on him.
Awesome. Yeah, we'll go into that sequence. Sounds good to me. So rules note, in this case where creative is you know, is playing one of the wrestlers, the control thing, like, one of my directives is to, like, you know, give it up when it's appropriate and stuff like that. So you can still interrupt. You can still spend a momentum to interrupt if I keep going and you're like, no, I need to do my thing. But I think this is where it clearly is going to pass back to you as you power through to get to reverse this hold, which sounds like a work maneuver to me.
Yeah, this is not, not
going to
be good.
Let me chip in something. What's this? He looks like he's reaching out. Maybe he's calling upon the power of the graveyard to help him get out of this tight situation.
I rolled a 4, which means I have a 3. This is not my thing.
We're touching each other.
No, I just hit you with pieces of metal.
I'm going to suggest to Joe he consider pushing you over.
That's what I was going to spend the the next level. Right. I built it up.
How does he pull? Yeah, how does he pull out this? So he's obviously struggling to reach the ankle to reverse this hold. It looks like Aiden's like really, who, you know, is a legit amateur wrestler, is just fucking with you, right? He's just stretching you. He's holding you and you know, not letting you get your shit in. But yeah, Joe, so how does it look when he finally flips him over and reverses the hold?
It's definitely sloppy looking, probably, because, you know, Aiden's the legit amateur wrestler. But, you know, he does have to, like, go with the, you know, the script, as it were. You know, he doesn't want to upset too many people in the back. So eventually, like, you know, they do transition. And, like, you know, they're like, I'm on the mic trying to sell it up. It's like, the graveyard's power is flowing through him. That's how he was able to escape such a devastating hold.
One of the production guys is on the ball and starts flickering the lights right when he grabs Aiden's ankle, so that, you know, it's like the power of the graveyard, right? Helps him a little bit.
There ought to be something in the rule book against supernatural intervention. That just, it doesn't seem fair to be able to call on dark spirits, but there's Timmy, nothing stopping him.
You have to learn, Timmy, in this business, anything it takes to win.
That's setting a terrible precedent in this franchise. Can't call any ghosts, ooks, specters, manifestations. Oh, man, everyone's got a...
The match stipulation.
Everyone's got to hang it up.
All right, so that bumped you up to 7-9. Would you like to retain control, or do you want to give it back to Aiden and gain a momentum?
I'm going to retain control.
Yeah, and I think this is going to go ahead and go into the finish. So you are booked to win this.
That's what I figured.
So you can go ahead and build up to that however you like.
So the idea I had, so I grab him by the ankle, I sort of reverse the hold. I don't really know what I'm doing, you know, like, our legs are tied up, and I'm just like, I don't know. So he, you know, smartly tries to reach for the rope, and all I know to do is to keep him away from the rope. Like, that's probably one of the, like, three things they drill into you in wrestling camp. They're like, look, if you're in a hold, stay away from the rope. So I get him away from the rope, but the hold is just loosening as we're fighting, because I don't have the skill to keep it.
Well, so, he's actually keeping his own legs locked so that it doesn't look like you're losing him.
Oh, okay.
He's too good. Now that he got his, you know, got to stretch you for a minute and kind of show you what he thinks of your lack of wrestling science. Yeah, he knows what the finish is, right? So he's helping you out.
Right. So I've got him up, and I sort of realize that this isn't going to work. You know, I don't have any way to control him from here. I don't have any way to put him out. Mm-hmm. So at a certain point, I let him go. And I let him go as he reaches for the rope. So he goes to reach, expecting the pullback, and instead there's slack, so he just falls on his face.
Mm-hmm.
And I use that time to I get up and I run into the rope, and I run back at him, and I just bicycle slide him right to the side of the face. And then while he's out, I jump on the turnbuckle and just do a frog splash and go for the pin.
Yeah.
Like I try to get as much violence and destruction in as quickly as I can to just try to knock him out.
Do you have a specific finishing move? I don't remember. Or do you just, like, your matches just all end in a flurry of violence?
I think that is my signature move. Just, I hit you three different ways.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it was...
It was like three or four moves, and you do some subset of them, too.
Yeah, I think it was Brainberg that dubbed my jump with the chair out of the ring the uncharitable.
Oh.
But I don't have anything other than that. I'll have to come up with a couple.
That's cool. Awesome. So yeah, you go for the splash, and that will be the 1-2-3. Go ahead and roll for your finishing move.
Come on, Dice. Don't fuck me now. Nope. 5. Ha! Good job.
Good job. Want to spend some momentum on that?
I got 2, so yes. 7.
Oh, and he's going up top. Oh, and then there he just took a nasty blow when he delivered that sickle right down Aiden Anthony.
He's sickle used splash. Every dirty trick in the book. He's used the street fighting. He's used the dark magic. Here he's got this relentless beatdown. He stole this victory from Aiden Anthony. Just grabbed it away from him and taken it for himself. Razor is dead, my friend.
Well, I see things differently, Timmy. He won, didn't he?
Winning is all that matters. Cost.
At what cost?
At the cost of Aiden Anthony.
All right, what is your...
So on a 7-9, I make him work for it. I can win clean, and we both get +1 momentum, or I sacrifice my body to make it happen. I get +1 heat and take a legit injury. Since he's a non-player wrestler, I'm not gonna spend my momentum. I'll botch it. I will legit injure him.
All right. Okay.
I'm gonna suggest you look at something because my memory might be off. But since you're the hardcore, you may have an advantage to taking an injury yourself. So look at.
I don't think I have that move.
You, on the back of your sheet, you should have the injury section.
Mm-hmm.
That applies no matter what. You don't need to take it as a.
No, I have the move. Are you not entertained that I haven't chosen? When you suffer an injury, endure humiliation, or go down in the face of overwhelming odds, roll plus three. Sure.
And then, do you see the injury section underneath that?
Mm-hmm.
So that still applies regardless of the are you not entertained move.
Oh, I gotcha.
So.
In this case, I can see it here, what it says is that you would get +1 heat with Aiden Anthony if you took an injury.
Oh, okay, I see. I kept skipping over that part. Well, I mean, I don't want an injury, right? I mean, +1 heat's good, but I only got 3 injuries.
That's true. Whenever you spend in advance, you can heal an injury.
On top of
whatever you're spending it for. So, well, they do go away. But it depends if you want to get injured or not. I mean, the story of this match kind of lends itself to it because you did take that bad splash in the corner.
Yeah.
But it's your choice.
Yeah, you know what? Let's go for it.
Yeah, we like injuries here. Sorry, okay, I'm trying to bring up mine as well. Sorry.
Okay, so I do spend my momentum. I get +1 heat. So now I'm at +2 again with Aiden Anthony.
Yes. So you don't botch the move. It looks great. What you do is you go so above and beyond
in sacrificing your body for it, that it hurts you. So here's how it works, because these two actually kind of stack. So you sacrifice your body to make it happen, you gain plus one heat with Aiden, and you take an injury, and then because you get injured, you get another heat with Aiden.
Oh, I see. I got three now. Oh, shoot. Step back. Plus three with a play, with a non-player character. Look out, y'all.
Yeah.
Badass over here.
You guys have something juicy going. Yeah. So you so you go up for the frog splash, or as I've dubbed it, the sickle splash, if you want to go with that. You launch yourself. You usually do it off the second rope, because you're not a high flyer. Mm. But you go all the way up to the top rope, launch yourself way the hell out into over his body. Hit it perfectly, and by perfectly for you, that's like with maximum impact, right?
Right.
Like the ring always makes that like kind of thump sound when people hit it. Makes that crack sound. Like, something really serious happened. The whole audience goes, ooh! And you feel something in your shoulder just pop from where he kind of smushed you earlier. Mm-hmm. And you get the 1-2-3 and the win. Which means that you are going to the semifinals, my friend.
Woo! Ah! My shoulder.
Yeah.
Oh, it hurts.
So, as injuries, this is the first time that injuries come up for viewers at home. Every gimmick has a different injury. It's essentially a move, but a different set of little rules that applies when you're injured. So for the hardcore, whenever he gets injured, he gets heat with whoever injured him or whoever he was working with, because he kind of can injure himself, as we saw. While Jason's character, for example, he can refuse matches when he's injured without any repercussions, but if he does wrestle, he gets additional momentum when he wrestles. So, showing us he's kind of treated gingerly by management, but he gets to show off his ability to keep going, stuff like that. Once you start into things that might be injurious, make sure to take a look at that, because they're designed to be, add another dimension to your character, not to keep you from playing the character. Cool. So you get the pin. And Aiden Nancy just lying, just lying there. The lights kind of go down just because you get mood lighting because you're special. What do you do with your post match? You just head off. Do the bones come out?
Yeah, I was gonna, I'm injured, so I give them the wave.
Mm-hmm.
And they come out, and they're just gonna, it's not, the full retinue, like Reaper gets. I get, two guys. And they just come out and, grab his arms and drag him up the ramp, and I'm, leaping after them, clutching my shoulder.
We're gonna cut backstage for a second. Jason, so Professor Atomo, has he floated his forming a wrestling science stable idea to creative?
I imagine so, because I had in mind a fair amount of props and people.
Mm-hmm.
So
Tina's watching on the monitor. So this is off camera. She's watching on the monitor at the end of the match. And she's so the two of you are standing there. She goes, he's just not a natural face. There's something so arrogant all the time, Have you talked to him about your stable idea? Because this is a really good opportunity, actually. Actually, I think this is a really good opportunity.
Well, I do need to get some people in there. He's got potential. I don't think he knows how to work the mic quite yet, but he's got some of the solid wrestling moves, and he's got good heat going. I'm willing to give it a shot.
Well, that's, you know, you can whip him to shape on the mic, I'm sure, and I think he just, you know, his whole bit about making that match about the wrestling, it just seems to fit.
Yeah.
It's like, I think, you know, so the bones go out to drag him off, and she's like, I think, she's like, go ahead and just, you know, go make the save. They'll roll with it. I think it's pretty obvious for those guys.
All right. So, Professor will call in the extras that he's arranged for this, and go for
this. Like, are they just like jabronis? Just like dudes?
He made sure to get a diverse arrangement of people, but they're all musculature. However, they are all wearing glasses, shirts, and bow ties.
Well, these are the guys, how, you know, when Reaper has his full entrance, that they're the bones, right?
These are my guys for that, yes.
Yeah.
So he'll have them, but he'll have them wait a moment while he goes out to put a stop to things. So there you go.
Cool. So how does that look?
All right, so the bones are there, and they're about to drag him off. And the professor comes out and is tweeting, he goes, "Hold on one moment. I put up with a lot of things here in the WWW. I put up with the rise of Sharkman. And as Bolt pointed out, I put him down. I won't have any more of these supernatural hijinks. I've done the research. I know that here in Philadelphia in 1943... wrestling science was used to make an entire battlecruiser disappear. The USS Eldridge vanished thanks to wrestling science. We don't need the mumbo-jumbo of the blind man. All we need is to change our mindset, to understand this new energy. And that's why I have formed the New Energy Research and Design Society. Yes. I put together a group of like-minded people, and we are going to put you down." And he holds up his arms, and out behind him, all the nerds come flying out behind him to go and push the bones away, and he strides down in the middle of them towards Aiden Anthony. And when he gets down there, you know, he'll throw a couple of fists to get him away, and he'll get Anthony into the ring, and he'll kind of help him up, and he's like,
"I'm going to use my showstopper move."
Yeah. Okay. Take your cheap heat, Jason. You're right here in Philadelphia.
Right here in Philadelphia.
Go ahead and that was an awesome promo. Go ahead and roll that, unless you have another move that applies, but I think...
That's fine. It was a different way than I was originally going to do it, but I think that it worked out pretty well, so... Here's my cheap heat, and rolling for the promo. I got a 9, and a promo is plus look, right?
Yes.
I think so. So that means a 10, so I get a momentum, and I get to pick from a list, I guess.
So I can put you in a match, add a stipulation to a match, and you're going to be wrestling Blind Man at some point. Gain a momentum or gain a heat with... I guess with anyone with a supernatural thing.
Fair enough. Alright, so I get the momentum for the promo, and I think what I'm going to do is, because I like having heat with PCs, is I'm going to go ahead and raise myself up with no longer Razor, because currently I'm at a 0 for him, so we'll go ahead and give him a 1.
Yeah, and since you're interrupting his moment, I think that makes sense.
Yeah. And like, Razor, Scythe, as you now call yourself. Oh, wait, I've been show-stopped. I can't keep talking.
Yeah, so let's
never
do
mind.
That.
So as you're about to get to Aiden, right, the lights just go out. The place is completely dark. And a second later, they turn back on, and I'm up in the, like, there's a second balcony, isn't there?
Yes, yeah, there's
totally. So, like, I'm up in the second balcony, like, right in front of the audience, and I've got Aiden, and I've got a mic, and I say, Professor Atomo, your wrestling science, your wrestling foundation, your research, all of it means nothing. You shouldn't be here. The future of this wrestling company I have seen, and it is a future without you and without your research and without any of these guys. Professor Atomo, I am here to make you a proposal. You and I, we're going to have a match tonight. And I want to put something on the line. You see, I've got something you want, and I kind of like pull up on Aiden's collar, right? And you're not going to get him unless you beat me. But in exchange, if I beat you, you are going to drop out of the Journeyman's Cup tournament, and you're going to give your place to Bolt Bradshaw.
That's awesome.
You're all for that.
Yeah. Take a momentum for the showstopper move, and then roll for your promo.
This is chilling, Timmy. Absolutely chilling.
I'm not sure I even recognize the world of wrestling anymore. Jesse, were things like this back in your day? I know it was a long time ago, but do you remember? Were they like this?
All right. 7 plus 2 is 9. And I am going to add that stipulation to this match.
Awesome. That is fantantic.
I'm just standing there like, guys, trying to drag someone off to the other world here. Like, you gotta...
like a normal Tuesday, guys.
Come on. He just gave me this, guys. Come on. He's gonna be mad.
I think unless you want to buck what Blind Man Simons is doing here, I think you just kind of fade. Like, you and the bones are just kind of gone by the time he's done talking.
Atomo scares us off, and then it's like, well, it doesn't. You don't matter anymore.
Yeah. It's like this became about something else.
Yeah, there's all the nerds have left, too, so it's just down to Blind Man and Atomo.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
I'm just out of shot getting looked at by a doctor. Like, hey.
Yeah, no, they get you off, and they take you back to the trainer's room to, like, check out that shoulder for sure.
I'm gonna be baby facing it up a little here. So Atomo takes a moment, he looks, you know, shocked, and then he thinks about it and goes, though it may put the entire future of the WWW of the world on the line to not have me in that ring. If you manage to somehow call on your dark magics and upset the match, I cannot let this fine wrestler, this person who stands for all the good of wrestling science, be left in your clutches. You'll have your match, and you'll have your stipulation. If you think you can handle it. And, so I'm going to blow two of my momentum and gain one heat.
I think that is a perfect time to do that.
Yeah, I could leave him speechless, I could make you book me in a match, and I could add a stipulation, but I'm pretty happy with the stipulation.
I know, it's well stipulated at this point, I'd say.
So, there go. No, my momentum!
I'm going to add the stipulation, right. The match is on a Tuesday.
And that puts me up to a 2 right now with Blind Man.
Great. Okay, that's awesome. Adams, is that where you want to end that segment? It's still kind of your call.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I got what I wanted.
Yeah, that's great. So we have that, we have this moment where Blind Man is still up holding Aiden, who's like fainted or something, right? He's like not really present, up in the balcony, and there's like a spotlight on you guys. And then there's a spotlight on Professor Atomo delivering that little baby face moment. And then there's a beat of silence after he stops talking, and then it cuts to a commercial right from there. So we're going to take a 5-minute break, and then we'll come back to the second half of this show, which is going really great.
Sounds good.
Awesome. I'll be back in a couple minutes.
So, I noticed that Scythe went first, again.
Because Nathan, I think, digs my character and wants to make him cool. and then I just keep rolling fours.
Well, no, I mean, it's fun. I want to build some heat with him because of the supernatural aspect, especially if he keeps standing in for Reaper. You got to start demanding hardcore matches, though.
I thought about it.
I like if you save those for special occasions.
Yeah.
It can be your style. Yeah, you did go first again, huh? I don't know. No, it's kind of like no matter what. Well, so actually there is a bit of ordering, and stuff. Piece like two played characters are generally going to go on later in the show, because you guys have more interesting stuff going on. Mm-hmm. And I haven't really been doing it intentionally, but yeah, I think Scythe has competed in the first match of the night, I think, four times in a row now.
Well, we set this up. I'm the guy that goes first, has kind of a flashy match, and then we get the real wrestlers in here.
And we get wrestling science.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
I spent a fair amount of time trying to figure out how to make nerds into my thing.
And it was time well spent, my friend. Yeah, in case anyone didn't catch that, the acronym for Dr. Tomo's new faction is
research and development or design, I think I said. Society.
Right. Yes, yeah. Nerds.
Joe put NARADS, but a real nerd would know that you never put AND in the acronym.
That's right.
But unless including it makes a word. Then it's fair game.
Right. But it's one of those like words. It's like how English has all these weird little rules. It's the same thing.
You don't put an I after an E except if there's a C in it, or it's Saturday, or if you just feel like it.
Right. Or if it looks better that way.
No, who's gonna stop you?
All right, so that is a really great. That was a perfect use of the showstopper move there, Adams. That's exactly what I had envisioned for that kind of thing.
Thank you.
So, well done. All right, are we all back and ready to get restarted?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Okay, so we come back from commercial, and of course the commentary is like, that was it's an incredibly unexpected development. We had thought that Blind Man Simons was clear out of the tournament, but he apparently has seen some kind of terrible fate for worldwide wrestling, and something about Bolt Bradshaw is very, very important. We don't know where this is going to go, folks, but We will keep you informed as to all the latest developments. Of course, the most relevant one here being that Professor Atomo, and perhaps aided by his NERDS, he's like reading off the thing, will be facing a blind man in our main event tonight. And then we camera cuts backstage, and I think we're going to have, Joey Crak, maybe like leaving the locker room after getting his stuff on.
Actually, have an idea.
Yeah, go for it.
For like a, you know, sort of pre-tape segment of Joey Crak throughout the set, going, you know, through visiting various sites in Philadelphia. Like, you know, he's got like classic, he's just in like his casual wear of his jeans, he's got his leather jacket zipped up. And, you know, this is like he's cutting his promo. So I have to face what meal maker to get ahead in this tournament, the farm boy in the city of Philadelphia, the home of hardcore wrestling. And like, it's like Philadelphia, it's not really my cup of tea, but you know, right here, this is the best part. And, you know, I was like, I stepped to the side, and there's the Liberty Bell, and I wrote Joey right in front of the crack in the bell. And then it's like, we cut to like outside the Chiefs, like Pat's and Geno's, and like Pat's and Geno's, the staples of Philadelphia, is just pure crap that you put into your body, just like meal makers, just pure the sheer crap of the company. You know, and just like this, he's going to be left in the trash. And, like, you know, then, you know, the next scene would be me in front of, like, whatever the football stadium is. I live in Philly. I don't even know. So, home of the Eagles. One of the most beloved sports teams in the NFL. A meal maker, he's pretty popular, but just like the Eagles, he's just going to choke in the end because he can't handle pure crack. And so, yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. So take your, you know, the live audience is watching this on the Tron, right? So take your cheap heat for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, roll your promo.
Come on. Ugh. 6-7.
Hey, 7. There you go. not a botch.
I know. I was like, all right. Whew. All right, so pick one. I want to add a stipulation to the match. That'll be a Philly hardcore style.
Okay. Right on.
Just to prove that I can dominate here like I can dominate anywhere.
Nice. All right, so maybe somewhere in there you were like just like carrying around a kendo stick or something? Just like some indication of the hardcore, like...
Well, we'd have one spot right in front of the bingo hall, basically, and like the home of the hardcore style. But everyone forgets that this is also the home of some of the greatest wrestlers. And while they had to deal with those stipulations, they managed to make it without ever needing to use a weapon. My body is my weapon, but I'll pander to this little crowd. I'll give you a taste of what hardcore actually is.
Nice. Awesome. So that cuts. The live audience is booing the Tron. Then we go to a live camera backstage, and you're coming out of the locker room. You come around the corner and come face to face with Travis Mealmaker, who's been waiting for you backstage. He's he has kind of that like older, like Southern wrestler build, where he's just kind of thick.
He's like Tracy Smothers.
Yeah, he pretty much looks like Tracy Smothers, except that his whole deal. So his original gimmick was that he was a fry cook, and then he's kind of transcended that. Like he's been around for a while, and he's been with the company for a long time. So like he doesn't really play that up anymore, but. He does where just like he wrestles in like overalls and like a flannel shirt, at this point he has just like a little like cropped beard, short cropped hair, and so you come around the corner and bump into him, and he's just looking at you, he's like. Like, Joey, look, I don't think we've ever really spoken. I don't know why you have to be saying all these things about me. I mean, I'm just here, right here, in Philadelphia, to put on a good show for these good people, because that's what they came here to see. But, if you want to go, you know, hardcore or whatever and pander to these people, I can pander. I can pander just like you. And he zooms out, and he's just holding a giant fucking metal skillet. He's like, you sure you want to do this, kid?
You look like you're used to holding something like that. I hear Geno's is hiring. You might need a new job after tonight.
It's like, you're just like, you know how many times I've heard that? I'll see you in the ring.
I think it'd be great if he started right then and there.
No, he's a good guy. He's a good guy. He'll settle us in the ring.
But I'm the bad guy, so.
Oh, you can. you want to, I mean, the plan is, you know, it's going to pretty much go out to your match. But if you wanted to jump him backstage, it's your...
No.
All right. Cool. So he's going to come out first. The camera kind of follows him out. And he comes out to a pretty big pop. He's like, you know, the constant upper mid card, has held the title a couple times, you know, is always kind of around the important stuff that's going on. But he comes out, he's just holding the giant frying pan. And he raises it up and walks down to the ring, gets his pop. And then he stands and waits for you to come out. And when you come out, he very deliberately puts it down, like, I'm not going to need this, kind of, and puts it down on the steps and then gets into the ring.
All right.
He's just staring you down.
Mm-hmm. So, like, unlike my normal ostentatious entrance, you know, I'm just, like, looking sort of like, you know, just marching straight to the ring, still in, like, the outfit I was wearing out on the streets and the jeans and, like, the boots and leather jacket. And, like, you know, I don't even take the jacket off. It was, I just, like, rush right towards him. And, you know, start, like, laying into him with, you know, given the hometown what they want, a nice brawl.
Nice. So yeah, you slide in and just start punching on him. He's punching you back. You guys are just trading punches. They ring the bell. Matthew, you be our announcer for this.
So Joey going right for the punches. He knew what he was getting into this match. I think Mealmaker made a misstep by underestimating him. He wanted a hardcore match, and he's going to make this a hardcore match.
Awesome. So we are going to be using the hardcore stipulation. So keep an eye out for when you draw blood, use a weapon, or revel in violence, because that's when that'll kick in.
Oh, no. I have to roll plus real.
Oh, no. What have you done to yourself?
What a terrible decision I've made.
Wrestling. So, yeah, so you guys are trading punches. I think you'll start off getting the better of him. So you'll start off with control after you kind of have your initial just kind of brawl and then break in the middle of the ring.
Yeah. All right. So like we brawl, you know, trading punches back and forth before I do my patented heel knee lift into the gut, mm-hmm. Irish whip him against the ropes as I rush the other ropes. And then like I rush towards him, dive forward with a flying forearm smash. But then, like, so this is probably trigger move. As, like, he's, like, down and out. As I, like, look down, I'm like, oops. As I, like, reach in the leather jacket and pull out a large metal pipe. Like, how did that get there?
you forearm smash him, and he just drops. And then you, like, pull it out.
Right. Yeah. As I, like, I pander to the crowd, I'm like... You wanted hardcore, here's your little... And, like, yeah, you know, toss it, like, towards the front of the crowd.
Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah, you're totally working the audience there.
Oh, shit.
Like, okay. Like I always say no to crack.
I have a plus two. I have an audience of two, so that's...
Some other pun.
Six and five, 11. Okay, 13.
They love it in the sense that they just start booing you once you drop the pipe and, you know, make your, like, derisive motion. So gain two momentum.
Ooh, two momentum.
Nice.
All right.
So Mealmaker's, like, he's just lying, like, cold cocked in the middle of the ring, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's kind of open for you to take this to the next place.
So yeah, like the next thing I would do is like I just like strut over to him and like, you know, place one foot on his chest and do the classic pose and the arrogant heel pin. And of course, like he manages to get up just at two. And I was like, all right. So and then like you know, lifting him up, but then like I see him as having like the sudden like burst of power and like, you know, I sort of like want a handoff narrative, I guess.
Yeah, I can take it. Quick question for you: which gimmick moves do you have?
Oh, I have Dynasty Scion and I Am the Future.
Okay, cool.
Oh, oh shit! I guess I made a promise.
Yeah, we'll do a we'll do that at the end of the match, I think.
Cool.
Yeah. So. Cool. Yeah. So he kicks out, he kicks out and just like you know pushes you back so you guys you know have a little clear space, and then you trade. He comes to you and you do a whole like duck a clothesline, bounce off the ropes, come back and he clotheslines you. And then you
know, I'm flapping and sailing.
Yeah, you're selling it. You get up. He comes off the ropes and he does these you know he does these big like you know the not clotheslines from hell but you know he does the big like big choppy clothesline. Mm-hmm. So he gets a couple of those on you. And then I think so. Someone in the like you threw that pipe kind of like towards the audience, right?
Yeah.
Someone leaned over the barricade and grabbed it.
The crack.
And is like making a motion like he's going to throw it back into the ring, and the ref starts going over there, and then Mealmaker actually runs, slides out of the ring, grabs it out of the audience member's hand, and this goes and he starts working the audience a little bit where he's just like, he's like. You really want me to use this? And, like, you know, half the audience is like, yeah, because it's Philly. And so May is, like, two-thirds of the audience. And, you know, the ones who are more, more on his side are like, you don't need it, you know. And so he, like, he's giving you a little time to recover. He walks around the ring, and then he just throws it underneath the ring. He's like, this can be hardcore without needing this garbage. And then he runs back into the ring and just starts giving you big forearms across the face, just driving you all the way back into the corner. Where do you want to go from there?
Oh, I think, like, as he, like, drives me back in the forearm, that, like, I do the classic Ric Flair tumbling up over the over the turnbuckle and start, like, walking along the apron as he knocks me down. I want to, as I'm climbing to the feet, like, I want to, like, reach in and just trip him by the legs and start dragging him out of the ring.
Yeah, for sure.
We're doing the classic, like, brawl throughout the arena.
Okay.
Yeah,
let's do that. As indicated our back channel. So yeah, you pull him out of the ring. You guys just start exchanging blows, but you start moving, you know, out of the ring area and then like down the side, and there's just like exit doors, right, that open out onto the street.
Well, I meant like brawling through the crowd.
You're going into the crowd.
Classic W style, just going through the crowd, them handing weapons, hitting with cups and drinks.
Well, now this isn't against the rules, but I guess as a hardcore match, there aren't any rules. Take your rule book, Sally, and throw it out the window, because that's where the wrestlers are going.
Cool. So you're brawling through the crowd.
And, like, one thing I want to do, like, while we're, like, doing the crowd, like, you know, climbing up to where the announcer's nest was, as, like, you know, like, he's got me on the ropes, because, like, I want to, like, be like playing up that I am like the cowardly heel, you know, I'm trying to get away from him. And as he's got me like teetering on the edge of the thing, I like want to quick like duck down, like do like the shoulder block to like lift him up and yeah, basically put him through the table beneath. You know, try
right,
to, like,
so you kind of lift him up and he falls down into the to the announcer's table.
So that's probably the
That's the hardcore move there. So roll plus reel.
Well, there's an 8.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, crap pops. Pick one. Somebody takes an injury, you gain 2 momentum, or gain a heat with Travis.
I think I'm going to take the 2 momentum.
All right, so you lift him up, and he drops back through the table, and the crowd just does a big like ooh, because it kind of didn't look like it was there. It was probably going to happen eventually, but this was it happened. It takes him a little by surprise, and there is a little there's a little EC dub chant that starts because it's really But
I wasn't sure if the fiction that existed or not. So
right, yeah, sure, yeah, yes, it does.
Okay.
I've decreed. But you also get there's a bit of a Joey Crack a little bit around you. People around you are like throwing their drinks at you and stuff.
Yeah. So
from that move I take control of the match as well.
Okay.
So you dropped him down through the table.
All right. Okay. So, like, before that, I just wanted, like, you know, I wanted to look like I was going to leap down on him, but I'm like, just no, as I take the safe way back around before, like,
Okay. Yeah. So, you even go up with the elbow, maybe, and then you're just like, you know. Yeah. And that's when they start, you know, booing and throwing the cups at you and stuff. And he's getting up and he's climbing his way out of the table. And you're walking back through the crowd, back down towards the ring, and that's when he gets his second wind, and he comes up behind you, grabs you around the. He's a little bigger than you, so he kind of reaches up and basically gets you in a headlock from behind, and is just giving you like the little stiff arms on the top of your head, right? As he starts pulling and he starts walking you towards the. This is where we're going to go out to the exit doors on the through the audience, okay. Where there's like the big exit sign and people, and there's like some refs there to clear people out of the way.
I'm running alongside with like a mic, just probably like 3 steps behind him. Like Mealmaker's taking him outside. What's he got planned? Is he gonna hit him with a car?
So you go out, you the two of you burst out the door, and you're just in like a I don't know, like, there's an alley on the side of the building, right? And there's some convenient aluminum trash cans full of paper and boxes next to the thing. And so he just, you know, he gives you another shot on the top of the head, and then he kind of pushes you back, and he yells loud enough for to pick up on the mic, where he's like, you know, you want a garbage wrestling? Well, you know, here you go, kid. And he picks up the garbage can and just jams it, like the, you know, turns it over so that all the shit's falling out and just jams it over your head.
And I'm like stumbling around blind, like, whoa, it's all dizzy.
Get me out of here! So he's, and that's when he starts, like, going back in, back into the building. He kind of, like, he kind of like pushes you into the other trash cans, and then it's kind of like, you're gonna need to get out of it to finish the match. So this is where you can pick it back up.
All right, cool. So like, yeah, we're crawling back out of the trash can, making our way selves back towards the ring. Mm-hmm. As I find a homeless person shopping cart because it's Philadelphia, and like, you know, as he's walking back, I charge him behind and like knock him backwards into it as I like pushing him towards the ring.
Okay. Oh, that's awesome. So, I think that's the hardcore move again. You're using a weapon and reveling in violence. And progressing the match forward.
So much for the violence, just for the comedy, but...
Well, it's kind of a comedy bit, but, I mean, hardcore applies to comedy as well as violence.
There's a 3.
Excellent.
The announcer wants to...
Oh, yeah. Do you want to help him out with this, or do you want to see what this botch looks like?
I'm torn.
So the how a botch works for this move is he plays it too safe or fucks it up. I take control of the match, and Joe picks whether he loses an audience or he takes an injury.
I'll put Joey over. I like Joey.
Thank you.
Joey's gotta win this. So he comes up from he comes behind him. I'm gonna guess that the camera shot that we're looking at that point is inside the arena, looking back at Terry coming in. So we don't see Joey with the cart until almost the last minute. So I'm doing just sort of like a fill time, like Terry heading back. Oh my God! And it's just Terry falls in it, sort of, you know, half his legs are hanging out. And Joey's just running him down. Joe, are you gonna like run him down the stairs or something with this, or?
Well, like, I was like, just he was walking back in. I was trying to like be all like desperately looking sneaky and like just rush to like have him tumble ass backwards into the thing. So like, I don't have to like carry him to the ring. I can just wheel him down to the ring.
Yeah, you just run him all the way down to the ring, and we just get back to it.
Okay, Joey comes from behind. He looks like he's got a shopping cart, and then we just cut through, and he just hits a path, just straight to the ring. And I guess Joey, you're just gonna run him into the damn thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm seeing they've kind of gimmicked part of the barricade. So you like hit it with the shopping cart, and it kind of collapses, and it goes up, and Travis rolls out of it. And that's. Gets you back into the ring area. Cool. And I think we're gonna take this home. So Joey, you are in fact booked to win this match. So
okay. So yeah, like a few more things, like working him over, like you know, like working his leg around the ring post in a figure four type thing before I like drag him into the middle of the ring, slap on the sharpshooter, the crack shooter.
All right. So I'm gonna throw in. So you know you work his legs. And then roll him into the ring, and then when you and then you slide into the ring or however you get in. When you pop up, he goes just because this is my favorite, so I want to get it in here, and I can do that. He goes for his finisher, which is the Meal Maker Deal Breaker, which is basically a stunner, Stone Cold okay. Stunner, but. Kind of facing the other way sometimes when it makes sense. But yeah, so he goes for that on you, and then you can either take it and kick out, it's up to you, or reverse it into your crack shooter.
Yeah, the take it and kicked out and kicking out is always much more like, you know, builds the crowd up.
Yeah, so he hits you. So this is the first wrestling move of the entire, other than a clothesline. of the match.
That is true, yeah.
Right. So he you know, you slide in, and when you pop up, he just, you know, out of nowhere hits you with the Meal Maker Deal Breaker, and the crowd pops. He comes over, throws, you know, he's exhausted, his legs are all messed up, he throws the one arm over you and kick it two.
Mm-hmm.
And two and take it away. Quarters.
Yeah, I get up at 2 3/4 as I, like, you know, like, stumble to the ropes to climb up and get, you know, get to my feet as I, like, and, like, call for the finish as I, like, you know, move over and grab his legs and to turn him to roll him over. And he's like, you want it hardcore? Let's see how hardcore you can go. Even though, like, we're just wrestling right now. And basically, yeah, I'm, like, wrenching it in, like, you know, and screaming from the tap.
Yeah. All right, roll for your finisher there, bud.
Keeping him away from the ropes, because that matters.
Mm-hmm.
Roll nothing, right?
Yeah, it's just flat.
Let me clear. Roll. So there's a 6, and... Can I spend momentum on this?
Yes, you can.
Blow it all.
I'll spend 4 momentum to make it the 10. Get that 10.
Yeah. Bam. All right. You hit it clean. Gain an audience. Simple. Yeah. So you drag him to the middle. I think he does, you know, one like reach out to the ropes, and you just drag him back.
Drag him back in.
Yeah. You yell for him to tap, and he, you know. He just starts tapping, and they ring the bell.
And I, like, oh, all right, so I'm going to spend another momentum to do my little heel move as, like, you know, I keep it wrenched in. So, like, I leave him, like, sprawled out in the middle of the ring.
Okay.
You know, because I'm a jerk. Because
you're a total jerk. Yeah, so you keep it, yeah, wrenched in after the, and they ring the bell again.
Yeah.
And then the ref comes in.
And he raises my hand, I take my jacket off and reveal the Phillies jersey, and I just, like, lay it on top of him.
Because you're a jerk.
Totally.
Nice. Yeah, you sure do. He is laying... that's perfect. Okay, so you hold it on. The ref comes in. Another ref comes in, they pull you off of him. They're ringing the bell, and then they help Travis Mill make her out, like he's on their shoulders. They announce, the winner of this match and advancing to the semifinals, Joey Crack. And you're just getting booed.
What was that?
All right. I think you kept a promise or followed through on a threat. Kind of both. That you made on camera, right?
Yes, I did.
So go ahead and roll plus look for that.
All right. Ugh. There's a 5.
Oh, that's perfect.
I can't even make it a 6. I can make it a 6. Doesn't help.
All right, that is perfect. Okay.
Yay, punitive match.
No, that's great. All right, so we'll cut to backstage. There's some business going on camera, but this is off camera. You come back, and Colton is there. See Colton Craig. And he's looking at you, and he's just like,
"What?
What did I specifically tell you not to do?"
Worry about the graveyard?
Well, that too. Mess with his knees.
Look, the crowd loved it.
I'm not saying the crowd didn't love it. They did love it, which is why I'm not going to make a bigger deal out of this. But, he's the trainer's looking at him now. And I understand it's very exciting, and you get carried away in the heat of the moment and all the stuff that I've heard before. But I specifically told you to watch out for his knees, and then there you go. Work the leg, fine. Crack shooter, fine. That's your move. I get it. Holding it in after the bell, torquing him, doing all that stuff. We need that guy. And he's a personal friend. So when I tell you stuff like that, you need to listen to me.
All right, so what's it going to be, Craig?
I need to talk to Tina and see what makes sense, but let's just say this. You're going to have a non-tournament match, and it's going to be a doozy for you next week.
All right, we got to do what we got to do.
It's like, I hope you're starting to get a sense of cause and effect here. All right, Joey, cause and effect. That's what I want you to think about. That's your homework.
Yeah, I get that, but you know what matters at the end of the day? The audience.
It's like that and your paychecks. And I control one of those. Remember that. Then he walks away. Awesome.
That's rough, yo.
That played in my hands perfectly.
Lousy.
Oh, no, that's great. Okay, we are going to... I think we're probably running a little long, but that's fine, because we're going to go ahead and jump to our main event. I think Blind Man probably comes out first for this. I think, we have... They go to commercial or something, and they come back. And it is time for our main event of the evening. Blind Man Simons versus Professor Atomo on the line. If Holt Simons wins, then...
On the line, a man's life.
Yes, a man's life and another man's career. Right, so I make sure that I'm remembering this right. So if Simons wins, then Atomo has to give up his spot in the tournament to Bolt Bradshaw.
Yes.
If Atomo wins, then he is saving Aiden Anthony from whatever fate awaits him at the hands of Blind Man Simon.
Yes.
Great.
awesome.
Yeah, from whatever mysterious fate awaits him.
Clarify.
Check.
This is kind of an altruism match, really.
Like, let's see. On the Graveyard wants to turn him into a zombie wrestler. Atomo wants to make him a wrestling scientist. Blind Man, I don't know.
Wants to do something that we don't want to know. What, that wants man was not meant to
take him into the desert and feed him peyote.
he's really going to enjoy that. Mr. Anthony will really enjoy that. So yeah, I think we will go ahead and go to Blind Man's entrance, which I don't remember what it looks like. So
all right. The lights turn out, a cover of Not to Touch the Earth with whispered lyrics starts playing. I begin to walk down towards the ring, and a spotlight flashes on me, and this time I'm leading behind me. His hands are tied in front of him, and I've got a rope that connects to those hands, and that's Aiden. I forgot his last name. That's Aiden leading behind me, and the spotlight goes out, and it flashes several more times as I'm on my way to the ring. And then, finally, it flashes on me in the center of the ring as I'm taking off my blindfold and revealing my red and my green eye. And looking straight at the camera. And there's also a second spotlight on Aiden, who is tied to one of the ring posts. And then the lights turn on.
Nice. All right. Turn back on for Professor Atomo.
All right. They can actually stay off for a moment for the drama, because first there's going to be a little Titantron moment, where the professor is sitting with his hands together and his eyes low, and on his forehead he has like a little strip that's got random blinking lights. And one of the nerds is holding up cards that the camera can see, and he's like, circle. Square. Wavy lines. I'm ready. And then he'll come striding out to his old familiar atomic playboys with the cheesy fog and lasers. And you know,
do you have nerds with you now?
I believe some nerds are accompanying, but they try to follow him down and he goes, no. And he leaves them actually back up at the top of the ramp. He's like, I have to do this alone.
No one can help me where I'm going.
So, and he'll stride down, and you know, he can see Aiden Anthony, and depending on control, I would go into work the audience, but
I think we will start with Blind Man having control. I think he's kind of this whole situation is kind of his doing.
It's all his machinations.
It's all his machinations are coming to fruition.
All right, because I'm a veteran and I'm in a match, I gain a momentum. There it is. Okie doke.
So Adams will start us off with how he wants to begin this match.
All right, I am going to start right off. The bell rings, we're facing each other, and Professor Atomo just, like, looks at me for a second, waits a second, and then charges straight in at me. But I grab his arm, and I put him into an arm lock, and we get into some complicated arm locks and arm lock escapes and arm lock reversals, and it's actually stuff that, in real life, Professor Atomo has been teaching me. But
right, because, yeah, you have a little mentor-mentee thing going on.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Well, that sounds like it is straight-up roll plus work for some wrestling action. Unless this is leading up to a bigger thing that you're going for.
What is Blind Man doing? Is he using the arms of himself and his opponent to draw out mystic sigils?
It's the all
right. I got -1 is 4.
All right. Professor Tomo, you can go ahead and counter this whenever you want, into whatever you want. And Adams, you give 1 momentum to Jason. So you lose 1, he gains 1.
Science versus mysticism, Terry. How will it play out? One man's life's at stake, another man's spot in the tournament.
Would help if I unmuted. I think the professor, being the game guy, is playing along for a moment, but then there's a stumble where Blind Man doesn't quite have an arm and it gets loose, and Atomo actually just turns that into picking him up and going for a side slam to break loose, and then he, you know, stumbles back for a moment to catch his breath after all those strenuous holds.
He's not as young as he used to be. a little gassed sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, just going for straight work, really.
Okay.
Roll at the moment. We'll see how that goes. And got a 10. Did that pop up? Yeah, it did.
Yes.
10 plus 2, so I got a 12.
All right. So it goes well for you. So it is a big side slam. And I think Blind Man is kind of left breathless for a moment. So you can gain 2 momentum, or you can gain a heat with Blind Man.
Ooh, tough choices. I was just going to gain the momentum.
Then he dangled back down there.
Yeah, well, right now my heat with him's at a 2, and I'd kind of like to have more heat with him because I feel like there's fun times to be had. So I think I'll do that. I'll go ahead and take the heat. So that'll put him at a 3 for me. And I think I still kind of want to work the audience. So I think the way to do that is, you know, he'll move from stumbling away to recover. And, you know, he's hanging on the ropes for a moment. And then he can hear the chant that's actually started by the nerds for wrestling, science. And, you know, he's powered by it.
The two-part like, chant.
And
one side of the crowd, you know, versus the other side.
And then, you know, at the end of it, he does the fingers to the head. And then... So,
awesome. Yeah, roll plus audience.
All right. Should have cleared that out. 1, 2... 14.
Right.
Good lord.
Very good. Do you get them on your side? They pop like hell. They are all about wrestling science right now.
As
gain
well,
two momentum.
Be. Hooray!
All right. You still have control. Remember, Adams, you can spend a momentum to interrupt if you want to. Also, you other guys can run in if you want to. Remember, that's always on the table. But yeah, the audience is totally into your wrestling science. Take it away.
All right. So I think what we're going to do here is that I'm going to help Blind Man up to his feet in the time-honored way of Wrestlers Everywhere by picking him up and throwing him at the ropes, and then throwing myself against the other ropes, and then just trying to meet him with a shoulder block in the middle. And we'll see how that goes. You know what? I'll tell you what. I don't want to do that. That's boring. So we're going to change it. So I throw him into the ropes, and I go against the other ropes, and I go for the shoulder block. But when I go for it, he actually ducks underneath it. And then I turn around, and he's there. So I swing my arm for his head, and he actually ducks underneath that one too. And we do the whole thing that he did in his first match, where no matter where I swing, I can't quite hit him until I'm like left breathing heavy, and he's just smiling at me. And then Atomo, you know, almost cries out. He's like, ah, and goes for a flurry of punches that are faster than any man his age should be able to do.
His quantum punches.
His quantum punches, and Blind Man actually just blocks or dodges all of them. And what I'm looking to do here is to work with Heat, actually, if Blind Man's willing to go along with this.
Sure. Sounds good to me.
The Blind Man's always one step ahead of Professor Atomo. It's like his third eye's wide open, telling him exactly where he's trying to strike next.
So I rolled a 6, and with him I've got a 3, so that gets me up to a 9.
Mm-hmm.
And it just doesn't make sense for me not to spend the 1 to get me up to a 10, because I spend 1, and then I gain 2. Right?
Yeah, unless you want to take another heat with him.
Plus 4 heat.
That's true. So he's already... I mean, Jason... Atomo's already at the top of the card, so it's not as important, but...
It's nice.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, I've got 4 momentum, that's plenty. I think I will go ahead and bring him up to the 4 heat, because I love me some heat. I also... I get a little uncomfortable when I get, like, 3 or 4 moves in a row, and the other guy doesn't get a chance, so I'm going to pass it off.
Yeah, you can hand it off.
And you go ahead and take a turn there, my friend.
All right. I'm blocking each of your quantum punches as they come at me, and I'm guiding us over, towards where the ref is standing in the corner, and suddenly, instead of blocking a quantum punch, I duck out of the way, and it puts out the ref.
Oh, red buff. Nice.
Something tells me, Terry, he saw this coming all along.
I roll off to your side, and I stand up, and I just wait there as you turn around, and that's... when I spit out the Asian mist at you.
Oh,
that's
no!
Yes, someone with the Asian mist.
Oh, my God, Terry, it's the poison fog.
Oh, God, this must be the weapon that he picked up in the desert.
And it's not just any
peyote mist. It's
hallucinogenic fog.
Hallucinogenic fog? Oh, that's great. That's totally your gimmick. Roll plus look for that. Unless you had something else that... is 4.
No, that seems fine.
I think, just roll plus look.
All right, 6 plus 2 is 8.
I'm gonna bump that up to the 10.
Yeah.
Because it's awesome.
I think you should.
Oh my God.
Why would you do that?
Because it's awesome.
It's the dreaded poison fog. No doubt he found it on his vision quest in the desert. God knows what this could do to the professor. He's not accustomed to such mysticism of the world.
All right, I'm going to take plus 1 heat with Professor Atomo. Sweet. And as he's... So he's around seeing visions.
Yeah, so this is a great moment to take it home, I think, unless you guys had more stuff you wanted to do in the match.
No, I'm cool with it.
The only thing I wanted to do was, well, I had two other things in mind, actually, but one thing I wanted to do was to actually use my put-over move and play up the effect of the mist, if I could.
Yeah, I think you should. So the booking here is for Blind Man to win.
What?
So.
From science.
Darn, I wanted to destroy Professor.
He'll still be.
I'm so sad about that.
Well, if you want to change that booking, you can break kayfabe to.
Yeah, but
make it so. It's up to you. Yeah.
You can be that guy.
That said, I think this is a great moment for you to display some weakness to your opponent for sure.
Yeah, the thing is, as a player, I would love the professor to keep on going with his meteoric rise. The professor's a veteran whose signature move is putting people over. So he's going to take the fall on this one. I probably have enough momentum that I could make it go, but
up to you, unless this is a sudden change in direction for him, which you could do.
I'll take the poison mist fall, I think. I think it is fair and right. But let me go ahead and roll to put him over here.
You, sir, are a babyface in real life as well as in the ring.
Shades of the great Muda.
So I rolled a 13 to put over.
Nice.
Which technically means we both gain an audience, but I'm still at 4, so
yeah,
this
so you
blind
just
man four. Gains an audience.
Yeah. Okay.
So there you go, sir.
Thank you.
You are welcome. And, go for your finisher, Chief.
Yeah, so how do you react to the mist?
Oh, I think it was the thing that he was not, in fact, ready for, because he thought he had the psychic part down. He wasn't ready for this. So what happens is he stumbles with his hands on his face, and when he pulls them away, he actually had little turtle shells to put in his eyes, so when he pulls them away, he actually appears to be blinded, and he just falls on his knees and screams up at the light, with a complete wiped out face, and then there we go.
Awesome. What is Blind Man Simon's finisher?
Honestly, in this case, I think I'm just going to walk over, I'm going to kick him in the side, and then I'm going to put him in a schoolboy pin.
just roll him up, schoolboy roll him.
Yep. Oh,
the most humiliating pin of all.
My man's very smart right now. He's got to hide that the mist-covered face of the professor. Who knows what would happen if the ref sees it?
Yeah, so the ref, you know, he's still, you know, groggy in the corner when, as the professor, like, wipes out his eyes and screams, and you roll him up, and that's when the ref gets up and comes over. He's all groggy and holding his head, but he comes over to count. So go ahead and roll for your finishing move. So.
Sure.
Terry, you and Timmy could learn a lot from the blind man and what to do in the ring.
All right, I got a 7.
All right.
No point in spending momentum because it would only bring me up to a 9.
Mm-hmm.
And that means that he makes me work for it. I can either get it the win through guile instead, or he can help me play up my unique approach, and we each gain 1 momentum.
It does both kind of apply. That instead might be a weird phrasing of that, but the intention is you use your wiles to get the pin as opposed to you just beat him with a wrestling move, which you've kind of done. But he's also playing up your unique approach, so kind of your choice.
Yeah, I'm going to take the getting the win through guile.
I think so. I think that. Because that will bring you up to 4 heat with him, right?
Yep.
Perfect. Yeah, so the ref comes over and he counts. He can't see the professor's face because he's all wrapped up in the roll-up. They ring the bell, and the ring announcer goes, the winner of this match, Blind Man Simons, which means Professor Atomo is out of the Journeyman's Cup tournament, and Bolt Bradshaw will take his semifinal slot. And there's a palpable like like moment in the audience, right? Because everyone was really excited about, you know, watching Professor Atomo just kick ass all the time.
Jesse, Atomo never should have accepted this match. He only had everything to lose here.
I have to agree with you there. There was no point for him to accept in this. I don't understand why he cared so much about Aiden Anthony. I mean, he's a respectable athlete. He's good at what he does. But to sacrifice this tournament, give this tournament up just for that man, I wouldn't have done it.
Awesome. Adams, what does your post match look like? What do you do after your hand is raised in victory? Or after Blind Man's hand is raised in victory?
I'm going to look around the crowd, like just like staring at them with my red and green eyes, turning in a circle, looking into each and every one of their souls. And then I'm going to put my blindfold back on. I'm going to untie Aiden from his ring post, and I'm going to lead him back up behind the curtain.
Nice. And yeah, so the credits will roll as he vanishes through the curtain with his hands out, you know, being pulled along by you. Awesome. And show.
What will happen to Aiden?
Ooh, poor guy.
Promotional consideration brought to you by Ready Bisque.
Okay, so Adams, you gained an audience, right? Because you worked a match where you had +4 heat with Professor Tama.
Yep.
So that takes you to 3?
+4.
That takes you to 4?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. So that bumps Atomo down to 3.
Hooray!
There's only one top spot.
I think we're all hovering around 3, right?
Yeah, so that's actually something I should have been doing, but I will do for the next one. Because I believe if you're all at 3, that's where the math kicks in to your audience has grown. Which is awesome. You get to play bigger arenas and you have more people coming to see your shows. But now you have new people you have to win over. So that's when your audience all resets down to your starting level again.
No.
So.
That's one of the reasons I wanted to put people over all the time, is I was like, get everybody's audience up.
Yeah.
So. I just got there.
Oh, always out of reach.
So I just made the world hate me.
The dreaded advancement.
Right. They still hate you. Now you just have to get other people to hate you.
Damn it.
But we'll look at that next episode with the roster that's there for that. Awesome. I think that's all the mechanical stuff. No one else got audience for heat.
Out of curiosity, rule-wise here, it would make sense to me to be able to spend some of my momentum that's still there on babyface move and demand a rematch with Blind Man.
Sure.
Because
you have it and...
Yeah. I have it and why not?
Sure.
It just doesn't make sense narratively. So.
Right. There's no really specific structure about that because I think that makes total sense. I think we'll go ahead, and it makes, you know, sense narratively and with your move anyway. So I'll go ahead and note that, like, you know, we need to get you guys a rematch for my booking next time. For sure.
Poison mist. Oh, so sad.
It's like you're ready for the mental stuff, but the
he had that of the whole game.
The mystery.
Just like, wait for it. Wait.
No, that was really good. Awesome. So, if there's anyone on your heat list that you did not interact with, either directly or through having a promo kind of targeted at them or something like that, go ahead and take one heat away from your score with them.
Oh. Does that count for people who weren't here?
I think that's
yes, count for people who weren't here.
Okay.
So would that little promo I had with Reaper, would that keep my one?
No. Yeah, we'll keep your one for that. Yeah.
Minimum of zero?
Yeah, minimum zero.
Okay.
Brainbird has finally fallen off of my
heat. Or Brainbird.
Is that
he's finally
does
done.
The saving of Aiden Anthony count as an interaction with Razor there? Or Scythe, rather?
Yeah, you were coming out to interfere with some of the business he was doing.
Okay.
I don't think it counts for me, though, because he was mostly out of it by the time I was involved.
Yeah, by the time you did your thing, it was like, this isn't about you.
This isn't about you anymore. This is about bigger things.
Yeah, this is about bigger things. Poor Scythe.
Come back to me when you come up with a wrestling discipline.
There we have science and mysticism.
Did you say people that weren't here don't apply or do apply?
They do apply.
Okay, so I went
otherwise
down with Bolt.
It's hard to make sense. Yeah. Yeah, because Bolt did not appear on this show.
Mm-hmm. Good thing I talked trash about Atomo and Scythe at the beginning of the show.
Keeping that in. All right, great. That worked out really well. Thanks, everyone. Mm-hmm. We will, I think we'll wrap it up now because we've gone a little longer than usual. So that is the end of episode 4. Thank you so much, folks who stayed with us through the thing or with us now, even if you joined us late. I hope you've enjoyed it. To find out more about the game, you can go to ndpdesign.com/playtest, where the current and forever beta playtest document is hosted. Also, look up the Worldwide Wrestling Google Plus community to join our conversation there. You can find me at ND, my last name, ND Paletta, on Twitter or patreon.com/ndpaletta to support my ongoing design efforts and small weird games, stuff like that. I'm going to go through our guests here and see if anyone has any other little plugs or anything they want to mention on our way out. So we'll go in that same order with Matthew. You have anything going on?
No, actually not currently.
All right, very good.
I think I'm the only person that isn't involved in some sort of thing.
That's okay. You'll get involved with some kind of thing at some point, I'm sure.
Someday you'll meet a nice girl, and I'll get involved with some sort of thing.
You'll get involved with some of this weird stuff that we do.
Some girl will have some idea for an Apocalypse World hack.
Right.
We'll go do a thing.
No, that's cool. And just, you know, since we're here, if there's stuff to throw a spotlight on, you're welcome to do it. Joe?
Well, here, I talked about this off-air. Go listen to Nathan be vaguely interested in a game on the last couple episodes of One Shot. I'm pulling his leg. It sounded like he had a good time, but...
No, I enjoyed playing the game. I participated in a playtest session of the Dracula Dossier adventure thing for Knights Black Agents, which is a vampire hunting spy game built on the Gumshoe engine. If you know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't, look it up. It'll make more sense. The Dracula Dossier is on Kickstarter. I was on the One Shot podcast playing a demo of it. I will go on the record as saying that Gumshoe is not my favorite game system in the entire world. However, I did enjoy that game, and playing with Ken and those guys at One Shot was really fun, and I think it gives you a really accurate representation of what that game does and what that product is going to be. So if you're interested at all, you can check that out over there.
I think my thing is when I'm here is to remind Nathan of something he did that he should mention to people.
Right. That is your most valuable asset. Joe, anything going on?
Bit in the future, but April 17th to 19th, me and some friends are posting a convention, Philly Games Con. It's going to be in Trevo's PA at the Crown Plaza Hotel. Check out phillygamescon.org. It's a work in progress, but we're getting there.
Great. Jason, anything going on?
I just recently put up my professional website, which is more about me being an arts educator. But if you go there, you can find the game that I wrote for the Golden Cobra Challenge, which is called Troop. And if people want to play it and send me some feedback, I would love to hear it. The website is coxart.weebly.com. And coxart.weebly.com, in the art section, you'll find my game. Try it. Let me know what you think.
Awesome. I will take a look because I'm interested in the Golden Cobra stuff, which is, for those who might be unaware, stuff that's on the spectrum of LARP that was made for a contest that's happening at the Metatopia convention that's coming up pretty soon. So live action-y to freeform to tabletop influenced, get up and walk around kinds of games. Awesome. Adams, you have anything cool going on or anything you want to spotlight for us as we head out?
No, not really.
Noted. Cool. Well, I will try to actually update the episode description with some of that stuff for folks with the links and whatnot. But in the meantime, thank you everyone for watching. Thank you guys for playing. It was a really solid session. I'm excited to see what happens with these guys next time. So thank you, and everyone have a great night.